everyone. I'm Lily Faulkner. I'm chair of the Student Government Elections Commission, and I just want to thank you all for taking time to come out tonight to our runoff debate. I want to remind you guys, you've probably heard it multiple times at this point, you can write questions down over here. Make sure they're respectful and that they're relevant to what we're discussing. And then if you come up with one during the debate, you're more than welcome to go write it down. Just find Xavier, will you wave? Find him, give him your question, and we'll try to add it to those that we're going to ask from the audience. If you were here last week, this is a little different. You can pose questions to individual tickets. And then you can also pose questions to just the presidential candidates or just the vice presidential candidates. And at this time, I'm going to introduce Hank Bowen, our student government advisor, to explain the rules of the debate and introduce our candidates and our moderator.
It's my pleasure to introduce our moderator and our candidates today and talk a little bit about the rules. If you were here last week, it's going to be a little bit different so that we have a little more interaction between our tickets. I introduce the candidates first and so that you can meet them a little bit more. Start with ticket three here, presidential candidate Laquan Rogers, vice presidential candidate Ryan Smith, and then ticket four, presidential candidate Joseph Ward. I messed it up once there already. Joseph Ward, the vice presidential candidate, Adrian Cox. I'll get to our moderator in a second. We'll talk a little bit about the rules for tonight. At this time, though, we ask that you put your phones on vibrate or silent out of respect for our candidates. The rules for tonight's debate are as follows. Before each question, our moderator will ask the first person to answer to step forward. The first ticket for each question will have 75 seconds to answer that question. The second ticket for that question will then have 90 seconds to respond. They can respond to the question in general, or they can respond to what the first answer was. Okay, so it's going to be a little bit more of that this time. They will have, again, 90 seconds for their response. Candidates will not be allowed to speak when it's not their designated time. Questions will be answered in rotating order, starting with ticket four. There will be a 15-second warning signal from an elections committee member at the end of each time response. He will give a signal that there's 15 seconds remaining. After the allotted time to respond has ended, the moderator will ask the candidate to stop their response. We ask that candidates and audience remain respectful and speak at their given time. So, candidates, if your time runs out, we ask that you stop at that time. Tonight, we're excited to have as our moderator Dr. Lathan Turner from the Office of Student Transitions. He has been on campus for several years and worked with a vast array of students, including now with student success initiatives in the Office of Student Transitions. And so, Dr. Turner, welcome you. We will begin.
Thank you, Mr. Boyd, Kelly, thank you as well, and to the students, good evening. At this time, we will allow each ticket to present an opening statement. Opening statements should be no longer than 75 seconds. Candidates will receive a warning when there are 15 seconds remaining. Due to the results of the coin toss earlier, ticket four will present their opening statement first.
All right, good evening, everyone. Thank you guys so much for coming out. For those who haven't met us yet, I'm Aiden Couts, running for student body vice president.
I'm Joseph Ford, and I'm running for student body president.
We look forward to another friendly competition between Laquan and Ryan for this runoff debate and election. It is unfortunate that ticket one and ticket two are no longer with us, but that does not mean that their best ideas are going to be forgotten. Our platform has several similarities with those tickets' ideas, and we plan to implement some of their best ideas with ours. Specifically, we'd like to implement ticket one's idea of a student organization liaison in an effort to strengthen our main point of making SGA more accessible to the general student body. We were very fortunate enough to receive the majority of the votes in the preliminary round, but in this runoff election, we hope that we get an even larger percentage of the student body to vote for us. We are extremely grateful to everyone who has come out and supported us through the journey, and we hope that people will continue to support us through this next week. Thank you, and good luck to Laquan and Ryan to this debate.
Right, hello everyone. First of all, we want to say thank you to all of you in the rafters. We see you out there. Thank you for coming tonight. This is the largest audience yet, so thank you. My name is Laquan Rogers. I'm a candidate for student government president.
My name is Ryan Smith, and I am a vice presidential candidate.
First of all, I just want to say, you know, our deepest fear is not that we're inadequate, but that we're powerful beyond measure. Certainly there are a common interest, the common interest in this room. And that is that we all have one goal, and that is to making the Student Government Association as viable, making it a thriving organization, making it perform well. This organization needs a CEO. It needs someone who can constantly audit why we do what we do. The second tier of this organization is experienced candidates. Candidates who have actually gone to SGA meeting, maybe currently involved in SGA meetings. It also needs candidates who are personable, who have relationships, who want to build relationships with students. So it's pretty simple. If you want to move East Carolina forward, ticket 3 is the way you need to be. Thank you.
Thank you both. We will now begin the first round of questions for the evening. Tickets will answer each question within 75 seconds. The other ticket will then have 90 seconds to respond to the statements made by the other ticket or answer the question. The first question this evening will go to ticket 4. As mentioned on last week, but for the students who were not here last week, what makes you qualified to serve the student body as president or vice president? Ticket 4 will answer.
Well, I'll start off and go over a bit of my qualifications. For those of you who weren't here last week, I've been in a lot of leadership roles on campus, mostly involved in Greek life, but I'd really like to get out and make a bigger impact on campus and try to help as many people as I can, because obviously Greek life is only a small percentage of our student body. And while I've had a lot of positive impacts there, I want to have a bigger impact on the rest of campus. I haven't been involved in SGA before, which some might see as a downside, but I don't believe that that's a necessary qualification in order to be student body president. What some might think I lack in experience, I make up for in the desire to succeed and the willingness to learn. The shadowing opportunity at the end of this semester will provide me all the time I need to learn everything I need to know and be the best student body president I can possibly be. I've been the vice president of KA for a year now. I was secretary before that, and they're one of the largest fraternities on campus, and I've been able to lead them and make them grow and keep us on the right path to doing all the positive things that Greek life does. And I want to turn that positive impact into a bigger impact on campus and empower the student body to grow and thrive and essentially just keep us on this great path that we're going now. And thank you. I'm out of time.
So experience is it's a very integral part of any leadership any leadership position. No matter if it's on the club level, if it is on the state level, the local level. Myself, my experience lies in SGA as well as ASG, as well as a fraternity. I was actually the vice president of Sigma Pi fraternity. I chartered with them. Also, during my time as vice president, we were the number 4 ranked fraternity on campus for GPA scholastics. This semester, I am the scholarship chair, where we are ranked after last semester, the number 1 fraternity on campus ranked in scholarship GPA. I'd like to also point out that I play a large role on the state level with SGA, serving as an ASG liaison. Now, the ASG liaison talks to different USC system schools. I'm very much in the know of what's going on both on the state level and on the local level. Myself, I know what's going on the Board of Governors. I know where the direction they're heading, where the direction of the Board of Trustees is heading. So that's really my experience. Very, very well aware of where we are heading as a university. And Laquan, as everybody knows, was in charge of over 800,000 students in the community college system, and that is his experience. It speaks for itself.
Thank you. What does it mean to be an ECU pirate, specifically in a leadership role on campus? Ticket 3 will answer first.
So let's I don't want to talk at you, I want to talk with you. Let's have sort of a fireside chat, if you will. What is most important as being a pirate is, number one, seeking to educate yourself. I didn't just decide one day that I wanted to run for SJ president, never met with anybody, never showed up to a meeting. I got involved so I can audit what needs to be done in the Student Government Association. So I'm not imposing my will or my seemingly authority on the Student Government Association. I've met with the administration. I play an active role right now, sitting on the Rules and Judiciary Committee. I have met with past vice presidents, presidents of this great association. So, first of all, as being a pirate, we seek to understand. We're intelligent enough to know the importance of educating ourselves before we try to influence others, because we could influence others in a wrong direction.
Thank you. Ticket 4 will respond.
Like in their motto, to be a pirate, we need to serve. We need to serve the students, and as if elected, we're going to be serving you. So we want to be able to serve you the best we can by leading. And Joseph and I have been able to lead through example, to jump in first, to help the community out whenever we can. And I think that's the most important thing that we need to do, to just be engaged with this great community that we have around ECU. We want this community to thrive, and we want it to prosper. And that's what being an ECU pirate is all about.
Thank you. How will you work to foster an environment of diversity and inclusivity among ECU students? Ticket 4 will answer.
So obviously this is a big issue in the national media right now. There's been all, especially because of the recent election, We have a bigger divide in the country than we probably ever have in what most of us can remember. And it's not just on a national scale. We've got local divides as well. And we want to bring ECU together and try to make that divide a national problem, not a campus problem. And in order to do that, we need to all come together. And I would like to lead everyone. I will be the student body president for everyone. Our main campaign point is increasing the transparency of SGA. And that means that anyone can come to us with any problem they have. No matter who you are, no matter what problem you have, we will try our very best to fix it. And more back to the point of the question, we'd like to obviously promote diversity, promote inclusivity on campus, and do so in a way that can benefit everyone, as many people as possible, because a diverse campus is a better campus, and it just makes the environment around campus better for everyone, and a more enjoyable college experience, because like these are the best 4 years of our lives, and we want the best experience possible. And the way to have the best experience possible is to have a welcoming and inclusive environment that you feel comfortable in and you can succeed in.
All right, back to Fireside Chat. Well, first of all, John Maxwell has a wonderful book, and he talks about the 5 levels of leadership. The 5th level is positional leaders. There's a clarion call on this campus for inclusive and transparent leadership. How are we going to promote diversity? Number one, take a look at us. Number two, through civil discourse, promoting civil discourse. We just don't want to tell you, hey, we're going to promote diversity. I mean, we can say that all day long. Through civil discourse. What have we done currently, right now, to show our efforts, to intensify efforts? We've already just showed up at other organizations' meetings. Just popped up. Just showed up. That's what we're doing. Brian, go ahead.
I would like to actually point out, what will you do? That's what you said. You didn't say, what are we already doing?
How will you work?
How will you? What we are doing right now is that we are actually tapping into voters who have never been seen by SGA. We are not saying this stuff, we are doing this stuff now. That's something that sets us apart from everybody else, is that people want to say what they are going to do. You can start right now. You're all students. We want to empower everybody. We want to make them feel like they can do something, such as promote diversity and inclusivity. through attending these events, and we want to intensify efforts, as Laquan said, to get more of a turnout to these events, and it starts with the students.
90% of success is just showing up.
Thank you. Students often complain about parking. Do you have any plans to improve this experience? And what would they cost students? Ticket three.
Could you repeat that question?
Students often complain about parking. Do you have any plans to improve this experience? What would they cost students?
So currently right now, as I stated the last debate, I sit on the Parking and Transportation Committee at ECU. This is a very black and white question. I know everybody here has heard the spiel about parking, that it will never get better. But there is room to have this civil discourse with administration, to open up these channels of discussion and have understanding between the administration and the students. Right now there are 600 parking spaces that are going to be reallocated, quote unquote, that's what they literally said, reallocated this next school year amongst the various campuses that ECU controls and is over. So myself being on the Parking Transportation Committee, I've already started these conversations. Vice Chancellor Bill Cope, I'm actually already in these discussions with him, and we've come to an understanding that I'm not going to always agree with Vice Chancellor Cope. He isn't always going to agree with me, but there has to be a civil discourse, and there has to be a student there willing to come to Parking Transportation, me being the only student that has done that in the past 2 years.
So, parking is always an issue in elections because everyone likes to have a place to park. No one likes to have to take the bus. No one likes to have to walk 30 minutes off the grid, all that kind of stuff. Everyone thinks they can magically fix the parking problem. Everyone claims that they're going to make parking spots for everyone, magically fix it. But truthfully, the root of the problem is the new construction at the new student center. And our plan centers around creating a short-term solution until that new parking deck is finished. Not necessarily creating something that can last for a lifetime, just creating something that will help solve a bit of the problem until the new student center is completed, because that parking deck is the solution to the problem. It's just 2 years away. A lot of the other tickets have said that they're going to work on it, but we have specific ideas about how we'd like to do some of that. There's some smaller private lots around campus. We were thinking about trying to create some funding to maybe purchase those lots, rent those lots, something along those lines. If we were to purchase them, we could sell them back to land developers once the new student center's opened up, get a bit of our money back. We'd also like to open up the spots on Central Campus and West End after hours so that people can drive to the library, drive to their club meetings, get some dinner at Mendenhall, anything that you might have to do. Just expedite the process so that you can drive to campus, get your stuff done, and go back home, and not have to worry about making a 20-minute walk or riding a bus and walking from the bus lot, anything like that.
The Student Government Association is known for the funding it provides to student organizations. What ideas do you have to improve the appropriations process? Ticket four.
So, for those of you who run our campaign platform, you've seen that we have an idea to try to redistribute the funds for undergraduate student organizations. And a lot of people think that is just an overhaul, that day one we're going to come in, rip everyone's money away, and give it all back any way we please. That's not what we're trying to do. We want the clubs to, if they have a concern, they feel like they need more money, go through the regular appropriations application. If the application warrants some action, we'll look at that action, and one of the main factors in determining the distribution of funds is going to be the size of the club, like we said. But that's not going to be the only factor. There will be some other ones we look at, the impact they have on campus, their number of members, like I said, how long they've been here, what their mission is, all that kind of thing. So we're going to work together to try to get clubs as much money as we can with the money that we have available so that they can make a bigger impact on our campus and our community, because undergraduate student organizations are one of the backbones of this university. And like I talked about earlier, we want to make this college experience as positive as possible. And having great undergraduate student organizations is one of the main ways to do that.
All right, thank you. We will answer this jointly. What I will say, part of any viable organization or being managing any organization financially is first auditing why we do what we do. The first thing we have to ask ourselves, how does that club or organization promote the mission of the university? We have to see who's impacted by our decisions. One thing, we have to make sure that the funds are being dispersed fairly.
Right. I'd like to go ahead and point out that great leaders, they aren't good at everything. They aren't experts at everything. And that's where leaders fail, is they try to be experts at everything. There's a reason why there is a treasurer. I just want to put this simply. Myself and Laquan, we aren't financial analysts. We aren't treasurers. There's a reason why we have a treasurer. That treasurer, we have an idea of how the funding process works. And actually not have an idea, we actually both know very well. We've read the funding guidelines. A lot of it is, that is already stated in the funding guidelines. But besides the point, the treasurer ultimately will decide that, and these funding guidelines are already in place. This stuff is already in place. It just needs to be clarified. And again, the liaisons to each organization will provide that clarity to each organization.
How will you develop relationships between organizations and student government outside of funding?
Thank you. We're going to do what we're already doing. We're showing up by invitation, and we're showing up at some of the events that we already see on campus. We don't want to reach you all through flyers and through emails and all those kind of things. You're busy enough. We want to be face-to-face with you. We want to get to know you. For instance, I had a conversation that lasted 30 minutes with a complete stranger. But before we left, we were friends. I found out information about her. She found out information about me. We had a very nice conversation. So we want to be involved. We don't expect you to come to us. We've got to go to you. And that's the problem with people who think that people have got to find the SGA office. No, we need to find you.
I'm going to continue this fireside chat kind of thing. I kind of like that. So our idea is to really create a student organization liaison. This person's sole purpose is to go to these clubs and to see what their issues are. Not saying that we don't want people to contact us, because that's one of the campaign things we wanted to say. We want people to contact us. But this director's purpose would be to go to these organizations and finding out what the sole problems are. That way we can bring those to the meetings and address them properly. We also want to set up some sort of Facebook Live or some sort of live video feed so that everyday student can watch our meetings and our debates, because it's all public anyways. It's just students just don't go. That way, if it's online, people can just go on their computer, see what's going on, and know what's going on in student government.
We didn't use all of our time. Can we?
Oh, by mistake.
Yeah. I don't think that's within the rules, so we will move forward. We will now begin the second round of questions for the evening. Tickets will again answer each question within 75 seconds. The other ticket will then have 90 seconds to respond to the statements made by the previous ticket or answer the question. These will be audience questions. The first question will go to ticket 3. What do you think is the most important thing Student Government Association does?
I think the most important thing that the Student Government Association does is advocate for students. This weekend, I went to UNC School of the Arts, and I really learned how to advocate for students on a state level. For example, right now we're trying to extend the add drop date for classes. I think that's a need that has not been addressed on this campus, but I think it'll be a plus. I think students will love it. And that is That is advocacy. I'm a student as well. I have that paradigm, and we just want to enhance the student experience, really. And that is through advocacy. That's through finding out what's going on at state level, being aware of what is happening, being aware of the documents of the Student Government Association, because a lot of this stuff that is on our on some platforms, it's already happening. It's just that nobody is advocating for students to use that stuff.
I agree completely with Ryan. I do believe that the chief purpose of Student Government Association is to advocate for students. We're hopefully going to be your chief representatives, and as such, we will advocate for you. On campus, the student body president serves on the board of trustees, and I don't mean to reiterate from last time, but I've got a pre-existing relationship with several members of the board of trustees. One of the members is a lifelong friend of my dad's who I've built a close relationship with over the years. I've gotten the chance to meet several of the others as well, and I feel like that my pre-existing relationship with them will help me be more confident in dealing with them, because everyone knows sometimes it's a bit uncomfortable talking to adults, especially important ones. But I feel like that my pre-existing relationship will help me be more confident and advocate for the students better with these people. In terms of state and local affairs, I've spent the past couple weeks over Christmas break shadowing at Vidant Hospital, and I shadowed Dr. Greg Murphy, who just won the District 9 House Representative seat, which is the seat for this area right here. And I feel like that my connection with him will allow me to better advocate for the needs of ECU in terms of the state government, because my direct relationship with him will allow me to directly express our concerns with him and have him bring those concerns to the floor of the state legislature.
Speaking of the trustees, if elected, you will be sitting on the board of trustees with Chancellor Staten and numerous high-dollar donors. What will you bring to the conversation on behalf of the students?
So I feel that I can be a voice for all students. Like I said, we want to make it easier for everyone to come to us with their concerns. And when they do that, I will bring those concerns to the board of trustees. Specifically on the board of trustees, I hope to serve on the Health Sciences Committee, and as a biology major who intends to go to medical school, I feel like I will be able to provide a great perspective on that committee. And as everyone knows, our Health Sciences Department has had a tremendous growth in recent years, and I hope that my perspective as one of those students can help us continue to grow in that area. Not that it's certainly a small niche of the larger programs we have here, but that's been one of our greatest areas of growth, and I hope to continue that tremendous growth going forward. Like I said, I keep reiterating the same thing, but we want to be transparent, we want to be representative of all of you, and if any of you bring any question or concern to me, we will address it in our student government meetings, we will address it with the Board of Trustees, and it will get taken care of, no matter what question it is, no matter who it comes from.
Thank you. Well, first of all, you know, from my experience on serving on a local board of trustees and a state board of trustees, you know, the first thing they want to know is that you know what you're talking about. They don't particularly care about, you know, your relationship with them. They want to know that you're advocating on behalf of students and that you care about the organization which you've served. If we want to talk about, you know, relationships, you can go on rogersmith.org and see our local and state leaders and what they say about the leadership build of this ticket. You know, if you know, I've represented on behalf of the work of the board of trustees. I've met with, you know, the former vice first lady of this nation on the behalf of the board of trustees. So I know the valuable role of that. And the most thing is that you need someone experienced and you need someone who knows what they're talking about. Ryan.
I want to hit on this real quick. It doesn't just stop with the Board of Trustees. I don't think everybody knows that. The Board of Governors is actually above the Board of Trustees. Board of Governors, we're having a problem right now in SGA, and I know this because I immerse myself into what I'm passionate about. I'm very passionate about this. The Board of Governors is in a sticky situation right now because they won't give the student member a vote, and that is because sometimes students are not experienced. They do not have SGA experience, and they do not know what's going on the Board of Trustees level. There is a learning curve to all of this. Let me go ahead and reiterate that.
Ticket four, question from the audience. You talked about making changes to the student conduct process and the Office of Student Rights and Responsibilities at the last debate. What have you done to educate yourself about the process already? And will you, and what will you do to, and what, excuse me, and what will you change about it?
So essentially the whole goal of that program is to increase student rights and privacy when dealing with the Office of Student Rights and Responsibilities. The whole reason I found out about this program is because my former fraternity president, Dallas Weaver, has worked, he was also the IFC president. He worked closely with the Student Government Association in that role. And he learned a lot about this program and let me know about it. And it's not completely implemented yet, and one of our big things is we'd like to implement it if it's not already implemented by the time that we hopefully take office. We educated ourselves about it by reading through the student rights and responsibilities procedures, educating ourselves about those, educating ourselves about what role a student defender could possibly play in this situation, how it might benefit students, and everything we've read seems to indicate that this program will be a tremendous success. And when we talk about it in all of our speeches, everyone has seemed very supportive of it. Everyone likes to have someone that's on their team and on their side and can help them out. And that's the whole goal of this program, is to make it easier on students who happen to be in that sticky situation, because it might be a little scary and a little intimidating, so we just want to help them out and make it easier on them.
Did we get a chance to rebuke that?
That was a direct question President Kennedy. For ticket three, President, a direct question. Can you elaborate on what your role was as president of the 58 community colleges that you served over?
You really want me to answer that? All right, get ready. So, as president of it was called the North Carolina Comprehensive Community College Student Government Association. There, I represent the 800,000 students that we have in this great state. On that board sat the lieutenant governor. On that board sat several CEOs of energy companies, et cetera, but that's not really important. What I did, every month, basically, I was in a different part of the state of North Carolina for the cause of education. I also represented the organization on a national level as I attended the National Legislative Summit, which was a summit for educational leaders. So I had opportunity there to speak on our behalf on the board. My job was to travel around to the schools. To give you an idea, I had to plan meetings, had to host meetings. Just to have one meeting cost us upwards of $50,000. So I had to manage a budget with the help of our finance team. I had to be proficient with Robert's Rules as I had to run several meetings with about 400 people plus in one room. So that'll give you a little tidbit of what my experience was there.
This question is for both tickets. Can you explain what the UNC Association of Student Government is and what they do? Ticket three.
So UNCASG is our governing organization, if you will, our umbrella organization, if you will. UNCASG brings together the 17 UNC system schools with four delegates each. And we come together and we solve problems on our campuses. That's basically what it is. We also lobby on the state level for things such as tuition raises, et cetera, et cetera. UNCASG is such a vital part of what we do here. They offer grant opportunities, funding opportunities that we would like to expand. They also offer opportunities for us as student leaders to talk with other student leaders about what's going on their campus and how they're handling it. Because with the recent events in this nation, it's very refreshing to see that you aren't the only campus that is maybe struggling. And it's also easy to overcome problems on your campus when you have a think tank of sorts to bounce ideas off.
Ticket three hit the nail right on the head there. They pretty much described everything that the UNC Student Government Association is about and everything that they do. And we, as student body president and vice president, we hope to serve and work with them to advocate for East Carolina in particular, but also for the betterment of all the other universities in this state. because some of us might have little siblings one day that don't end up going to ECU but go to UNC or go to NC State. And we want to advocate to make all of the North Carolina systems great so that everyone, not just people who go to ECU, but everyone in North Carolina can grow up and have a great college education and contribute to our local economy and the betterment of our community.
For both tickets, with our nation divided over with the immigration ban, how can you show students, especially international students, they can feel safe on their campus?
So, like I said, we really want to promote an environment of inclusivity and essentially just a welcoming environment for all students. No matter where you come from, no matter what your background is, everyone's a pirate. And we want to make that known to everyone. Like I said, everyone that comes to this university contributes in some way. And we want to make sure that everyone feels like their voice is being heard, that they are contributing, and that no one voice is too small to make a difference. That's why I keep going back on this idea of everyone being able to come to us with issues, because we want everyone to be able to feel like they have a voice. And no matter if you're an international student, if you're from right here in Greenville, you have the same voice, and your opinion is still valued. And we want to make sure that that is something that everyone feels comfortable with, and everyone on campus feels like they're welcome and included and valued.
I don't know if anybody's familiar with the acronym DACA. That is Deferred Action Child Arrival. In my former role, I worked previously with people who were affected by that. First of all, we've got to understand, as a student government association, we are nonpartisan. So we don't look at things from the eyes of political parties. What we do, we're here to be a voice for the students. We're here to encourage them through difficult times. We're here to stand with them in difficult times. We're here to let them know that they have a voice, they have somebody, they have an organization that cares. And no matter what, we encourage them that we will get through this together. Ryan.
I'd like to also add that ASG, again, I don't want to harp too much on ASG, they do a lot for the school system, UNC school system. Most recently, they have drafted, in part, they have been a part of, which makes me also part of the process in putting legislation on the floor for this topic, especially. We also have, ASG has attorneys, the school system has attorneys that work closely with these families, and we do advocate for these families. We are the voice for these students, no matter color, creed, race, ethnicity.
Last question from the audience. What is the one thing that you have learned through this entire process? We'll start.
Through this process, oh, what a process. I have certainly, there's been some values that have been, I would say, reinforced. And that is the goal of any president, moderator, CEO. We do not serve because we want self-claim, fortune, fame. We serve because we care. We serve because we care about every individual student. We serve because there's a cause. And it is our distinct duty not to become lackadaisical in that process of service, but every morning, wake up happy and ready to succeed on behalf of the students of East Carolina University. That's why we've been out here. You've probably seen us in the wee hours of the night, so that'll speak for itself.
I think it's also, it speaks to, it's taught me that hard work and dedication, it doesn't go unnoticed. I think everybody knows what I'm talking about when you look at the numbers. We didn't touch any large groups. We did this through being personable. Laquan and I, we have our differences, but we really come together, and it really makes people excited about why we're doing what we're doing and who we are. So,
thank you.
Well, I guess, I can say that from this, we learned that hard work, like you guys said, it pays off. I learned we need to be the voice
for the students, and we need to create an environment where students feel welcome in the student government. And that's one of the problems that we're facing with the student government now, that no one seems to really care. And we just learned of the lack of caring from the students day in and day out from student government. We want to create this environment for people to care. We want to be your voice.
Speaking on the not caring part, this is a little bit off topic, but there, if anyone's familiar with the ECU Professor Twitter account, I'm sure most of you are, but he put out a poll earlier this week, and it asked who they were going to vote for in the election. The three options were ticket three, ticket four, and I don't care, or I'm not going to vote. And we were pretty neck and neck. It was about 25-25 split between us two, and 50% I don't care. That's the biggest problem, is because no one sees what SGA can do for them and how they can represent them as students. And that's our biggest campaign thing, is we want to make people care about SGA and care about what it can do for them and how it can impact them.
Thank you. At this time, we will allow each ticket to present a closing statement. Closing statements should be no longer than 75 seconds. Candidates will receive a warning when there are 15 seconds remaining. Due to the results of the coin toss, ticket four will present their closing statement first.
Well, I just want to start off by saying thank you all for coming tonight, and I hope this debate has further enlightened you on the details of both of our platforms. As Aiden said in the opening statement, we plan to utilize the best parts of the other platforms in order to further improve our own. If Ticket 3 is declared the winner at the end of the week, I hope they will do the same and implement the best parts of our platform into theirs in order to create an overall platform that is most beneficial to as many students as possible. If this is the case, we will definitely be disappointed. We hope that Ticket 3 will allow us to work with them in some capacity in order to further advocate for our goals of improving SGA, improving our campus, and improving our community. Should we be fortunate enough to be declared the winners, we will certainly take the best ideas from their platform and incorporate them into ours to, like I said, make a platform that is better for everyone. We certainly hope that Laquan and Ryan will be willing to work with us in leadership roles so that they can still make their voices heard. Because obviously we're the two that have the most support, so we would like to still work with them to make sure that the voices of their supporters are heard. Not that we won't be representative of everyone's voters, but we want as many people who are influential to be as close to us as possible. Specifically, we hope to hear the ideas on further developing student clubs and organizations, as these are main issues in our ticket as well. We look forward to continuing the momentum into the runoff election. Again, thank you for coming, and best of luck to Ticket 3 this week.
We'll answer this jointly. I'll close in saying, as I used to say as lead attorney of the Pitt County Teen Courts, ladies and gentlemen of the jury, you've heard the arguments and evidence presented tonight. You have a choice to make about the next CEO of the Student Government Association. One thing you've got to keep in mind is experience. We're certainly right now part of the organization. We understand, so we're not coming in not having a clue about what's going on. It is your job to put the most qualified individuals in this position. We serve because we care. You can check out our platform on rogersmith.com, and I'm going to yield over to the best vice president anybody could ever ask for, Ryan Smith.
So I want to hit on real quick one thing, and I really want it to resonate with everybody. As stated, it seems like a lot of people don't care about SGA. And being a member of SGA for so long, I get that, because I come up to people all the time and they're like, "What? Why should I care?" I really want everybody to take home this one thing, is that SGA cares about each and every student on this campus. It's about advocacy, and we truly care. We don't just stand up here just yelling out stuff that sounds good. And I implore each and every one of you, when you go home tonight, to call or text two or three people and say, get out and vote. Give the website, our website, as well as their website, and tell them what you think about each ticket. And that's what I'd like to close on.
Thank you, everybody, for coming.